I have this burning flame inside of me. That's what moves me.
Germany, Brazil, and the United States are the countries that help shape the extraordinary life story of Norbert Gehr. To know him is to learn how history and fate shaped his destiny.
I am a risk taker, like to be challenged, and I like to overcome those challenges. That's what makes me who I am.
Son, brother, entrepreneur, father, leader, innovator, philanthropist, supporter, and friend. These are just some of the defining roles that describe Norbert.
Norbert Gehr, what an amazing life story. But let's go on the journey together with him in his words. Norbert, let's start back with your parents.
When my father returned to Germany after World War I, he discovered that the region in which he was born had been annexed to Poland, and therefore the whole family moved into the new borders of Germany, to Berlin, where they established themselves and became rather successful with a small department store. And all six brothers and my grandmother worked in the family business. But as the Nazi regime took hold, it became more and more difficult to live in Germany. And they got to the point where my father decided that it was not worth it to stay there. Friends would walk past him and turn their heads as if they didn't know him. And some of them would even turn their heads and spit on the sidewalk in spite. So he decided that was not a lifestyle that he wanted to continue to have. Berlin was the capital of Europe in those days, culturally. And with respect to every aspect of life, including the best concerts and the best entertainment and nightlife. So when he decided to leave Germany and go to Brazil from all places, his brothers were just amazed that he was making that decision. But they thought that this was passing in nature and did not want to relocate at all. The youngest of the six brothers, my uncle Herbert, decided that he would do likewise. My dad was the oldest, and my uncle Herbert was the youngest. Mm. However, if you were Jewish in 1933, when Hitler became the Chancellor of Germany, he already could not take too many Deutschmarks out of Germany. Mm-hmm. So that when they got to Rotterdam in Holland, a port city in Holland, to get on a ship to Genoa in Italy, and then finally board a ship in Genoa, which would have gone down to Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, they discovered that they did not have enough money to pay for two tickets. So my uncle very unselfishly gave my dad his few German marks, and he went back into Nazi Germany. And I always admired him for being so unselfish and so giving. I knew about it, and I grew to respect and admire my Uncle Herbert very much. As late as 1938, he was still in Germany, mm-hmm. trying to get an exit visa, which was no longer being given. And that's another aspect of my Uncle Herbert that I learned to admire, which was persistency.
His uncle discovered that Shanghai was the only country in the world at the time accepting Jewish refugees. He would eventually make his own way down to Brazil with the help of his brother. Norbert would be born in Brazil, and it didn't take long for the young Norbert's entrepreneurial genes to surface.
But as a young man, I was rather unconsoled with the idea that Brazil, a country of continental dimensions, did not have a drop of oil. And it imported that like 97 or 98% of their oil needs. And I wanted to become a part of the effort to find out where this oil was hiding in Brazil.
How old were you at that time?
I was 17.
So you were pretty young, and you were already thinking as an entrepreneur.
Well, I just liked the challenge. So I decided that I would have geology as a major in college. But unfortunately, most universities in Brazil at the time did not have a geology major. The few geologists in Brazil and petroleum engineers had gone to school in the United States. I decided that I would do likewise. But my father was not doing very well in his business and could not afford to support me in the U.S. going to school. So again, my Uncle Herbert, because of his distrust of banks, he actually had cash under his mattress that he kept just in case he had to run away one more time. I told him about my idea of going to the United States to study geology, and he reached under his mattress and pulled $800 and gave it to me.
Once again, Uncle Herbert became the hero. But $800 was not enough to launch Norbert into the United States in what would become a lifelong pattern of challenges and solutions. Norbert found one.
I had a number of friends in high school who were politically very strong because their families were very politically connected. As a result, they introduced me to the governor of the state in those days. And he asked the president of the Brazilian Lloyd, which was a shipping company, which had a fleet of freighters, which called on ports in the United States to make available a passage for me in one of those ships.
When the port authorities inquired about his destination, they were surprised when he said New York, since his goal was to receive an education in California. But Norbert, always a step ahead, knew between working full-time to support himself and going to school, he would not get to see the United States for a long time. So he decided to start his journey to California in New York.
I walked off that ship and saw a taxi cab. The driver asked me, "Where to, Mac?" A lot of American movies flashed through my mind that I had watched as a kid. And a couple of them were about Times Square. So I thought that I would venture to say Times Square Hotel, not knowing that such a place even existed. And to my own amazement, he drove to 43rd Street in Manhattan, and there it was, the Times Square Hotel, which was, up to that moment, a figment of my imagination. And it was a beautiful hotel.
What was your impression as a young man coming to this country from Brazil?
It was very impressive. Especially in New York City. So I couldn't wait until I ran up to my room and dropped my little suitcase and came rushing back downstairs, and it was very late. It was like around midnight. And I was just amazed that all the stores were open, and the street was so well lit, and families were walking up and down. One thing that I noticed on the way up was the fact that I went past the New York Times building, and they had all of these trucks being loaded up with bundles of newspapers to be distributed to newsstands around Manhattan. And that stayed in my memory for many years, and I later on helped me to find the Times Square Hotel building decades later when I was building my own hotel in Manhattan.
What a contrast, though. Look at that. This young man comes from Brazil, goes to New York, Times Square, and then what year did you build your hotel there?
2009. So a long time afterwards.
But what does that make you feel like inside?
Well, it made me feel like I went full circle.
And that's kind of where it all began for you, really.
Exactly. That's exactly right.
After a couple of days of seeing the impressive sights in New York City, he remembered a friend from high school who was living in Washington, D.C. He discovered his friend had already bought an airline ticket to return to Brazil, but instead, his friend cashed his ticket, bought a car, and the two young men headed out to California together. It didn't take long, though, to understand why the car was such a good buy. The two travelers didn't get but 50 to 100 miles on the Pennsylvania Turnpike when their troubles began.
There was this loud whistling noise coming from under the hood. So I told him, I said, you know, we need to stop and find out what's going on. So we did, and we almost burnt our fingers by trying to open the cap of the radiator because it was boiling. And once we managed to open it, it was like a geyser of steam, you know, and hot water. So finally we stopped at a gas station where there was an honest mechanic who told us, boys, you've got a serious problem here. He says, you have a cracked engine block.
That's really serious.
I said, wow, what does that mean? How much does it cost to fix it? He said, $800. $800, that's all the money I have. But then I looked out and saw that they had a number of leather bags hanging from the hooks. So I told Mario, I says, you know, that may be an answer for us. If we buy this very inexpensive, if we buy half a dozen of those leather bags and fill them with water, hook them onto the front bumper, and that's how we made it all the way out to California.
That's a great story.
Every time it started to whistle and the steam come out from under the hood, we'd stop and pour some water into the radiator.
Time for a drink.
Yeah, exactly.
So then you got to California.
Right.
And where did you go to school here?
First I went to a junior college in Orange County to improve my English. And then eventually I went to UCLA. But while all of this was happening, I had different jobs that were kind of menial jobs, and until I got a job in the quality control department of a food company, Standard Brands.
It was during this period, however, when Norbert learned there wasn't a big demand for geologists. He discovered that some people with degrees in geology had taken to menial jobs, including carpentry and driving taxis.
And so I was just shocked by it because there's really not much of an opportunity for a geologist.
So what did that do to your ambition?
Well, first of all, I had decided not to go back to Brazil because the Brazilian government started to nationalize the little that there was in the oil industry in Brazil. And I had a much more entrepreneurial view of what I wanted to do in oil than to become a civil servant. I then decided just to quit college and go to work. Ended up with three jobs at the same time. I worked from 9 to 5 at this import company in Hollywood. I then drove back to City of Commerce to start my work in that quality control laboratory between 6 and 12 midnight, swing shift. And for good measure, over the weekends, I worked as a cashier for the old Frank Taylor Ford, for a dealership downtown LA.
Where did you get that kind of drive and ambition?
That's just my nature. I always had this burning flame and wanting to be successful. After a while, I decided there had to be a better way to go about getting ahead. So I would get a pocket full of dimes, and I used to go up to this phone booth in La Brea and start with AAA, AA, B, A, C, A, D, etc., going down the line and offering my services. What I told them was that basically that I believed that I could become an asset to their business. So I got turned down, 99.9% of the time. Until I got to A, double L, Allied Wholesale. And this fellow, Ronnie Newberg, answered the phone. My name is Norbert Gehr, and I'm calling you because I really believe that I can be an asset to your company. So I says, kid, because you had the guts to call me and cold turkey like this, I'll agree to see if you can get down here within the next hour. So I did go down there. He said, before anything else, because if we discuss anything further, I'd like you to go back to my warehouse and look around and then tell me what you think. So I did that, and I felt that this was really like a university in the best sense of the word, because he had all kinds of general merchandise ranging from jewelry to hand tools to kitchen appliances to you name it. I went back to the front office and said, yeah, I'm really interested. And he said, okay, so I'm going to offer you a job for $400 a month. I said, I'm sorry. Says, I'm making $600 a month already. I'm trying to get ahead, not go backwards. So his reply was very short. Either you accept my offer or you just take a walk. I thought that over the long run, I'd be better off taking that offer, although it meant less money. And I rose through the ranks and became the general manager of the company. Eventually, they went into the mail order business and had over 100 employees, and I was running the business, basically. I was making $25,000 a year, driving a Cadillac convertible, for a kid that was 20.
That's pretty impressive.
22, 23 years old, that was not bad. But I could not grow beyond that point unless I bought the business, and that was not in the cards.
So what would become a pivotal turning point in Norbert's life? He decided to launch his own company. Discovering a vacant storefront on Ventura Boulevard in Studio City, he began what would become one of his strong suits in business to negotiate for the lease.
He was asking like $200 a month rent. I had to convince him that if he had 8 months to go on his lease, if he made it available to me for $100, which is all that I could afford, he would be losing only half of what he would lose otherwise. And he ended up agreeing with me, and so I rented that space. I was focusing on expendable products, construction and industrial, like cutting tools, hoses, industrial hoses, construction hoses, pressure sensitive tapes, and products like that.
He realized that navigating the LA freeway systems was not productive. So with his usual determination and optimism, he made a phone call to the old Statler Hilton. And to his amazement, he made his very first telephone sale.
That was the beginning of telemarketing. I was probably the first one to create telemarketing regarding tangible products. Created a rather explosive growth because over the phone we could go nationwide.
So did you learn when you were with Allied where to buy these things? Is that you? So you had
absolutely, yeah. And so all I had to start was $2,000, which was the result of my selling my Cadillac convertible. But I had enough credibility with some of the companies that I dealt with while I was at Allied Wholesale so that they were willing to give me products on consignment.
Where did this really strong ambition and drive come from?
I'm a believer that immigrants take a lot less for granted than everyone else. So that's one aspect that I think is important in terms of explaining the drive.
Your family, they were in business first before they moved out of Germany, so they were entrepreneurs.
Yes.
You were sort of almost had that work ethic inborn in you.
Absolutely. Because everyone wants to be successful, but not everyone is willing to pay the price.
Mm-hmm. And the price is?
The price is sacrificing your social life, working 10 to 12 hours a day, 6-7 days a week. And when you're starting from scratch, that's what it takes.
And I have a feeling you have no regrets about that.
No, none whatsoever.
But you were able to, you know, some people seize opportunities. You were able to create opportunities.
Yes. I believe that to some extent that is true.
A self-made man means what to you?
It means starting from nothing, not inheriting anything, not being given anything by anyone, and having to build everything from scratch. This was the foundation of businesses that I created over time. So I decided that after a while I had to become basic in manufacturing. But I had zero experience in that field. In the process of contacting copper wire producers back east, I started to visit them and learn a lot about that part of the business. And at the end, I decided to be much more vertical than I had intended. After a while, I learned some of the tricks of the trade, how to solve problems, and it became a very successful pursuit. At that time, the sales and marketing business was very sizable. That's what was generating such a huge demand for product that would justify getting into manufacturing. And because I started to acquire all the buildings that were required for the existing operations at the time, I then became very interested in real estate. In 1984, I acquired substantial properties in that field in Sacramento, Long Beach, and Downey, and got very involved with multifamily residential properties. And eventually expanded into shopping centers and office buildings in Florida, and eventually into hotels in New York City. The defense business came about by my wanting to have sort of a return to the roots at a period in the given time period. And I went back to Brazil and bought a house in Rio, in this most beautiful location with the greatest views and such. But after lying by the pool for a few days, I concluded that I could not continue to do that and decided to start a company there as well.
Through his vision, ambition, determination, combined with that burning flame, Gehr Industries was launched.
The group of companies is made up of three main business units. Gehr Industries, which is our original business in the electrical field, electrical products. Gehr Development, which is the real estate arm, which owns and operates multifamily residential properties in California, industrial spaces in California, and currently hotels in Manhattan. And the Gehr International, which operates only in Brazil, and it's a defense and security organization associated with some of the leading defense companies in the United States, Europe, and Israel. From missiles to communication systems to battle tanks, military electronics, intelligence systems, and all the rest. We're basically a sales and marketing organization there, an after-sales service, and we do that in association with some of the main defense companies in the world, like General Dynamics from the United States, the Boeing Company, KMW from Germany, Israel Military Industries, Israel Aircraft Industries, Astronautics Corporation of America. You know, in fact, there's very little in common between the business units. They just came about via my becoming interested in those particular fields. I just enjoy the challenge of creating a business from scratch.
Well, you really smile when you say that, by the way.
Yeah.
You enjoy that, don't you?
Because I do enjoy it, absolutely, yeah.
And you like hard work.
And I think that's really a very important key to being successful, is that you need to really like what you do if you're going to be excellent. If you're just going to be good or very good, you don't have to love what you do. But if you want to be excellent, you have to really love what you do. And I happen to love everything I do. Although I'm very fortunate, as I said earlier, to have a very great number of very capable, competent executives who help to run these companies. But I continue to be very much involved in every aspect of all of the companies.
We had the opportunity to continue our conversation with Norbert at Gehr Industries in California.
This was one of the most meaningful presents that I ever got, and I got it right at the time that I started my first company, mm-hmm. first business. And it sort of tells the story, sums up the trajectory that I have traveled since then, always pushing the rock, which means always facing up to challenges and overcoming those challenges. They forgot to tell me that 48 years later, I'd still be pushing the rock. But being that I can't remember who it was, I don't know who to call to file my complaint. I don't mind still pushing the rock today, meaning that I still enjoy my work. And taking on new challenges is always a good thing.
While we were there, we had the opportunity to meet some of his longtime executives. And it was interesting. Each one of them had a special business relationship with Norbert before joining him full-time. Galen Ho has been with Norbert almost from the beginning. They started out together at Allied Wholesale.
Norbert was just a young man himself, starting out with a vision and a dream. And I was a young man just starting out needing a summer job. 49 years have passed, and I'm now in my 50th year, and I haven't left yet.
David Lifschitz began his business relationship with Norbert when he was at Anderson.
It was a division of Anderson that was more of a consulting unit. We did do audits for clients, but we also advised entrepreneurial companies, small companies, medium-sized companies, and some of them are large but privately owned. The common theme was that there was an entrepreneur, a strong entrepreneur usually. It took him about 6 months of courtship. Mm-hmm. But you can't say no to Norbert.
Mark Goldman served as Norbert's personal counsel for 30 years before he came on board full time.
Most of the people that are here just started out with Norbert in a different capacity and just wanted to be here. And so that, you know, I don't think it's an accident. He's one of those people, I'm quite sure, that if you took away all his assets and put him in a brand new setting, in a few years, he'd have assets again. You know what I mean? And that it's not an accident. It's not by inherited wealth. It's just that he knows what he's doing.
Alfred Somek's introduction to Norbert came when he was working at a property management company. And that's when he started to manage some of Norbert's properties. And now he manages his real estate holdings, including his hotels in New York.
So tell me a little bit about the hotel, because he landed in Times Square as a young man when he first came to the United States, and now he has hotels there. So that's a pretty interesting full circle.
It is interesting, and actually it's interesting, the one night Norbert and I decided in New York, we were looking at different sites, and there was one site we were looking at in particular that we went over to, and Norbert said, I want to see the first hotel I've stayed at. So we went searching all over the Times Square area, and we actually found it. There was a big plaque. It was called the Times Square Hotel. And you should have seen him. He was beaming when he took a look at that sign and said, I can't believe this is here.
Each of these executives have solid reasons for their longevity and their special relationship with Norbert.
Works with us to lead us in the sense that he gets in the trenches with all of us, puts in long, 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 long hours, sets the example of good work ethics, and is a good teacher, self-driven man, to be successful for himself and for his family. At the same token, he is very loyal to employees, okay, who have given them all their lives, and he's also very concerned about their welfare and will reciprocate any time that he can if he can help them out.
Just a great man, and you feel that way about him, and so it's easy to be loyal. And he's also sort of like a father figure too, where he just takes care of people. He loves business, and it's a challenge. Over a period of many years, I've said to him, why are you doing this? Why are you even taking risks? Why are you gonna go buy another hotel? Why are you gonna do this? But, because I think his answer, and I'm probably paraphrasing, but his answer was, because that's who I am. So it's in his genetics, really, that this is what he does, this is what he enjoys, this is what he loves, and he just wouldn't be the same person.
He's one of the few people that can dreams about things and makes it happen. He's a champion of everything, anything that he wants, and he's so focused, and he's a mentor, he teaches. He's loyal to us, he thinks about us, he thinks about our families, he cares about our families, and that, you know, that's from the heart.
One word to describe Norbert.
One word? Driven.
Tenacious is one of the key words that comes to mind. I've seen him in situations where many other people would have given up, and he keeps going, whether it's in business, whether it's negotiation for anything, whether it's personal asset, or whether it's negotiating for someone to come and work for him.
The word that I keep thinking of is respect.
It is. That's exactly it. In fact, that's really probably, I could have simplified everything I said by using that word, but the people who work for him really respect him. We don't think that we know more than he does. We just, in fact, we learn by him. And he just has a wonderful skill set.
I have a tremendous respect for him and admiration. When you look at his life story and what he's accomplished.
What's it like to work with Norbert year in, year out, decade in, decade out?
You can't do it without liking who you work for.
I learn from him every day.
And that's what I like about Norbert.
One of the things that have surprised me the most is the level of loyalty and long-term allegiance that I've been able to develop in people around me. At times I have stopped to think about how come this has developed the way it has. I understand the basic fundamentals that may bring that about, but still, at times I'm in awe of the fact that at the end of the year, I look at the list of people to be recognized for longevity with the companies that make up our group, and I'm sometimes really surprised, both surprised and amazed, at the number of people that have been with one of our companies for 25 years, or 30, or 35, or 40, or 45 years. So in answer to your question, if anything has ever surprised me to a certain level, that would be it. Yeah. That bond and that level of loyalty has seemed to me to be rather amazing at times.
And I believe that this company has a heart, has always had a heart, and has dealt with everyone in that manner.
There must have been times along the way that you might have been discouraged and thought about quitting. Did you ever have those thoughts?
When things were not going as well as I anticipated, it just meant that I needed to work harder and do more. And figure out how to solve problems in a better manner.
Do you ever have fear at all, or that homesickness, or any doubt?
Well, of course. I experienced some questioning of what I was doing at certain points in time. But I never turn back. I always move forward. I had made a decision and I decided to stick by it. Yeah. So.
Conviction.
Yes, well, yeah. In the very beginning, there were times where I would cry on my pillow at night, really, because I missed my family and my parents and my brothers. And there was not a reason for me to decide to go back in what I had decided to do. So I knew that I had to stick it out, and I did.
Norbert's passion for his businesses, his work, and his employees is clear. But let's talk about perhaps his most important passion and role, and that's father to his four children. Now, what message would you have for your children, from your daughter to your young sons? What messages would you have for them about life, about career choices?
They need to find a field of endeavor that they can be in love with, so they can be very successful in pursuing their different choices. And to me, it really doesn't matter what those choices will be, so long as it is something that they really believe in and something that they will love doing. What I hope the most for my children is that they should acquire a deep understanding of the importance of tolerance. So whatever they believe in, they expect to be respected, and likewise, they need to respect what everyone else believes in terms of religion, politics, and sports even.
When your children look back as they get to be, now they're teenagers and you have your daughter in her 20s, but 20 years from now, what do you think they'll look back on their dad, and what do you think their thoughts will be?
I don't know. I hope that they will develop positive thoughts about their dad. All that I know is that I've done my best on their behalf by providing them with the best education available and the best orientation in their lives. And hopefully they will realize over time that that was all to their benefit.
Now, you just took your family on a big trip to Israel and Greece.
It was an opportunity for me to spend time with the children. I felt it was important for me to do something memorable in nature. One of the highlights of the trip, in my view, was our visit to Yad Vashem, which is the Holocaust Museum in Jerusalem. And I think it was important for them to understand better the background of our family, at least on my father's side. And hopefully generate more appreciation and admiration on their part about the wisdom that their grandfather demonstrated by leaving Germany as early as he did, which, as I explained to them, would otherwise not have made it possible for me to be born. And consequently, for them to be born. I think their reaction was very positive because they acquired a greater understanding about where they come from.
What do you think your parents gave you that when you think of your parents now, I know your dad's risk and courage.
What they gave me was a sense of responsibility. Work ethics and a sense of fairness.
What have you learned about life, Norbert?
Possibly not as much as I should have.
But are any things that you would have done differently about that would be a philosophy that you might pass on to your children?
In my business life, no. I think that I did what I thought was the right thing to do. In my personal life, oh, maybe I could have done better. But again, that goes under the heading that nobody's perfect, and we all make our mistakes along the way.
What are you most proud of when you look at these four children?
I'm proud of the fact that they are making good use of all the efforts that their father and their mother put forth in order to give them the best possible education, which is of fundamental importance for their future.
You know, if they were describing any one of your children, if they were describing you to one of their friends, and they would say, my dad is what?
Probably too old-fashioned.
What do you do with your kids that are fun? What would they say is fun about you?
Probably not as much as they'd like to see, because I work as hard as I do, and I do my best to spend time with them and take them different places. And I come from the old school as far as discipline, good manners, the ability to develop good relationships with others. But all in all, I think that they still love me in spite of my responsibilities as a parent.
Is there anything that you would want your children to know that maybe we haven't talked about?
Well, above all, I think that what I would want them to know is that I love them very deeply. And although at times circumstances cause me to be like a cop on the beat, and being the disciplinarian that I believe that I have to be as a responsible parent, that I, above all, love them very dearly. And that is the thing that I really like him to understand after it's all said and done.
Intellectually, we all understand mortality, but emotionally, have you been able to deal with that, or how have you been able to?
I'm a born optimist. If I weren't, I would not have been able to do a lot of the things that I have done. But on the other hand, I'm also rather pragmatic and a realist. So there are two sides to my makeup. One is this born optimism, and on the one hand, and then on the other hand, my ability to also be realistic. So facing the current situation regarding my health, the same two concepts apply. On the one hand, I'm optimistic about the outcome. I feel that I'm physically and mentally geared up to deal with it. On the other hand, on a realistic level, I have to consider the possibility that things may not go right. And for that reason, I needed to prepare myself and my affairs, organize my affairs in such a manner that everything will be taken care of if worse comes to worse. I have a lot of reasons why I would want to survive this challenge, as I have other challenges, with a special focus on my children because they're so young and still
today. My twin boys are 15 years old. My youngest is only 14. My daughter, who's the oldest, still only 23. And I think that it would benefit them if I were able to be around longer until they mature more than they have by virtue of their young age.
I know that you're not a one to be boastful about what you've accomplished, but what are you the most proud of?
Well, I, in terms of my business life, would be the fact that I was able to create these companies from zero, from scratch. That I was able to create employment for hundreds of families, and a sense of security and long-term continuity. And in terms of my personal life, that I was able to have these four children, and given the best guidance that I know how to give.
We didn't talk about philanthropy. Is that something important to you?
Yes, it is. It's very important. And I have contributed to many charities over time. But more recently, I decided to create a charitable foundation, which is called the Gehr Family Foundation, with substantial assets going into it, and in hopes that my children will take the lead over time and become very proactive in the decision-making processes and deciding which causes are worthwhile supporting.
But what is your overall philosophy of life? And you hinted towards it when you said how your children would have tolerance, you know, for others, but your philosophy of life encompassing all of life.
Well, that's quite a question that you're asking. I would say to be the best human being that you can be in dealing with others, whether it be family or friends or business associates, just to be the best human being that you can be. I have stopped working for money a long time ago. Because fortunately, I have not needed to make more money. But I always needed the challenge. And I will always continue to need that. For as long as I live, I thrive on taking on challenges. That's what makes me tick. That's what makes me be who I am. On behalf of 450 some employees that make up the companies that we have presently in our group, and to their benefit and their families and my children, those have been my objectives, and I think that I've achieved them. I feel really good about what I've done. No one, no matter how long they live, become all-knowing. There's always more to learn and more to experience. I just think that I did the best that I could with my life.